We have taken our 3D object, specified its vertices relative to an origin in a coordinate reference frame. What happens to a triangle to turn it from this representation that we've got, the vertices, the faces, into pixels on the screen? We've got faces, we can now transform them by applying a transformation at every vertex, so we can turn them and scale them and move them around. But how does that now fit into the bigger picture? How do we go from the local space of our 3D objects in which its vertices are defined into a 2D representation on a screen? Well, there are several stages and they're all different transformations that we apply. The first one is from the local object space of our representation into world space. So we pick an origin for the world, which I suppose we'll say is the middle of the table, and we then apply a transformation which re-specifies all of the vertices of our 3D object in local space in terms of the world origin. So what we're basically doing is saying, well, we want our pyramid to be at plus one in X or minus one in X, minus one in Z, two in Y. We can also then rotate it and scale it if we like. And we can do that with several objects and move them all to different places. And each will have a different transformation which places it in the world. It moves it from its local space to world space, and that is called a world space transformation. What we can also do, because we can combine transformations together, is specify one object in terms of another, so that we can nest these different transformations, so that we might want to stick this pyramid to that one. And so it has a transformation that moves it from its own local space to the space of this pyramid, which then moves to the world space, wherever we want to place it in the world. And so we can nest things that way. All we need to know really is where each vertex is in the world. We need to know its world space position. All of the vertices then need to be re-specified from world space in terms of the space of the viewpoint. If the viewpoint is here, say, this is our little camera, and it's looking out on the world. As we turn the camera this way, what we actually do is apply a transformation to everything in the world, which swings it over this way. So the camera really never moves. All we're doing is applying a transformation that appears to move everything relative to the camera. We're re-specifying all of our objects in terms of the local space of the camera. And this is view space or eye space, if you like. So it's really, it's just another transformation. All we're doing is moving from world space into view space. We're re-specifying one coordinate frame of reference in terms of another. So just like we moved from object space, the local space of the pyramid, to world space where it was positioned in our world. We're now moving from world space into view space, which is again just another transformation, and we can actually just combine those transformations and have a world view transformation which combines both of them into one. And so all we need to do is apply that operation at every vertex on every single shape. We then need to project down from 3D space into 2D space, which again is just another transformation. Everything is just another transformation. A projective transformation is a little bit different to the others, because whereas before we were just applying translations and scales and rotations to move objects from one space to the next, now what we have to do is have a special transformation which removes all of the depth information from the scene and squashes all of these vertices down onto a 2D plane. And also, because we might want to have a perspective effect whereby objects in the distance seem smaller, we need to collapse and scale them down based on their distance and so on and so forth. And all of that is encoded in the projective transformation. So yeah, so what have we done? We've taken our local representation, moved it into world space, constructed a scene out of our pyramids, and then moved all of those relative to the eye, so we know exactly what's in front of us and what's going to be seen. And then we collapse all of those down into two dimensions. So what happens to a triangle to turn it from this representation that we've got, the vertices, the faces, into pixels on the screen? Well, let's just draw some pixels out. Not very many pixels, the resolution's a bit low. So let's just take a random triangle and draw it on. Let's draw it in purple. So here's our representation now. It's been squashed down into two dimensions. And what we now have to do to turn it into pixels is go through every pixel here and decide whether or not it's inside the triangle. Now, I've not drawn very many pixels on here, so it's not going to look very good. But we can say that this one is pretty much inside the triangle. This one is pretty much inside the triangle. And for argument's sake, I'll go with this one, and these two as well. And so now what we've done is taken that simple geometric representation and discretized it. We've turned it into a representation that no longer has any information about vertices and faces. It just says this pixel is inside this triangle. When we collapse down from 3D to 2D, some of the vertices are going to lie outside our field of view. And in that case, we need to clip them. What we have to actually do is generate another two vertices here, because we don't know what's happening to this, because it's not part of our representation anymore, because we have clipped it to the viewport, as it's called. The problem is now, as you can see, we've no longer got a triangle. So, well, we just use our old trick of turning an odd polygon into a triangle representation, into two triangles. And then the process of deciding which pixels are in the triangle proceeds. But for these two new triangles that now fit perfectly inside our viewpoint. And that's called clipping. And then the next step beyond that is just colouring in the pixels and deciding exactly how to shade them and light them.
We'd like to thank Audible.com for their support of this Computerphile video. And if you'd like to download one of their huge range of books, go to audible.com/computerphile and you can download one for free. I'd like to recommend one today, my favourite computer related book, and one of the first books that made me think, hang on, computers could be cool, and that's Neuromancer by William Gibson. So get onto audible.com/computerphile, download your free book, and thanks again to audible.com for supporting this Computerphile video.
Working in 3D. We'll incorporate the table into this because this is where the shadow is being cast. The table is another 3D object in our 3D world, and we're doing a shear operation in four-dimensional space